I imagine that right now you're feeling a bit like Alice, tumbling down the rabbit hole. Let me tell you why you're here. You're here because you know something. What you know you can't explain, but you feel it. You felt it your entire life, that there's something wrong with the world. You don't know what it is, but it's there, like a splinter in your mind, driving you mad. It is this feeling that has brought you to me. This is your last chance. After this, there is no turning back. You take the blue pill, the story ends. You wake up in your bed and believe whatever you want to be. You take the red pill, you stay in Wonderland. And I show you how deep the rabbit hole goes. All I'm offering is the truth, nothing more.
For we are opposed around the world by a monolithic and ruthless conspiracy that relies primarily on covert means for expanding its sphere of influence, on infiltration instead of invasion, on subversion instead of elections, on intimidation instead of free choice, on guerrillas by night instead of armies by day. It is a system which has conscripted vast human and material resources into the building of a tightly knit, highly efficient machine that combines military, diplomatic, intelligence, economic, scientific, and political operations. Its preparations are concealed, not published. Its mistakes are buried, not headlined. Its dissenters are silenced, not praised. No expenditure is questioned, no rumor is printed, no secret is revealed. But I am asking your help in the tremendous task of informing and alerting the American people.
And now, welcome to another episode of Down the Rabbit Hole. Here's your host from FederalJack.com. It's Popeye.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to another live edition. It is Wednesday, February 19th, 2014. Tonight's edition of DTRH, I'm going to be getting into guns and cannabis, how they're both connected to our freedom. How am I going to do that? Well, I have a documentary that I've been wanting to play for you all. And it's called, appropriately titled, Guns and Weed, The Road to Freedom. And it's up on Federal Jack, and I'll drop the link into the chat room. And if you're listening to the archive, just go to the search bar on federaljack.com and type in guns and weed. Very simple. And hit enter. And it'll bring up, I think it's the second one down. And you can watch the whole movie on Federal Jack. But I'm going to, because I cut out about 15 minutes of it. Because there's some, you know, like the intros, and they do like some singing and dancing and stuff in there. Interesting way of getting the information across. But the information they get across is accurate. So what I did was I cut out all the interviews and all the pertinent information and put it together. Edited it back together so that, you know, all that other stuff is out of there, and audio-wise, because you guys can't see that stuff anyway, so there's no point in it. You get the information across. You get the important information across to you. Again, if you want to watch the full movie, it's over on federaljack.com. It's called Guns and Weed, The Road to Freedom. It's a really good documentary, and the point that they make, which you will hear, is that, you know, the gun folk and the weed folk need to come together and realize that they have a lot of things in common. You know, and we need to stop being afraid of each other because of stereotypes. Because of stereotypes that were created to keep us separate. You know, a lot of people look at the cannabis crowd as hippie liberal retards. And then a lot of people would look at the gun crowd as crazy right-wing nutbags that need guns, and why do we need guns in a perfectly sane, normal society where nobody hurts each other? But that's not really reality. And in all reality, the two sides actually have more in common than they realize. Because you know what? The people with the weed, the cannabis, well, they could use the guns and the people with the guns to protect them from bad people that would want to come rob them. And well, the people with the guns, well, you guys get sick. Weed's a medicine. Cannabis is a medicine. It reduces everything from anxiety, pain, inflammation in some cases, helps the body repair itself. I could go on and on. Stops cancer, helps all these different diseases. You people that like guns, you think you're not prone to get cancer or any other sickness? Cannabis is a medicine. Think about it for a second. See, the whole problem this country has right now, and this is what spurred me to want to play this tonight, the problem that this country has, okay, is that nobody gets along with everybody or with anybody. We can't get along with each other. Again, this country can't be taken down from the outside. You'd have to have like China, Russia, and you know a bunch of other countries tag team up on us. And just because of who we are, there would be people inspired to fight with us. Because of what we used to be, I should say, not who we are now. So what do you do to take a country down like that? Well, you get the country to take itself down from inside. You get the country to tear itself apart. How do you do that? You get the country to fight over everything. Everything. Why do you think, no matter what the topic is, you have Fox News and CNN and MSNBC for? What do you think you have them? What do you think the three of them are for? They're to help formulate a side of an argument for you to pick. Get it? All of their arguments, I mean, a lot of times they have a valid argument because they bring someone with a valid point on, but it's to create this division, it's to create this it's them versus us debate. When if we all got in the same room without them and without the powers that shouldn't be, yeah, there might be some heated debate and yelling back and forth, but a lot of that comes from the programming that everybody's been put throughout our whole lives and the lies we've been told. If we all just sat in a room and put all those preconceptions to the side and for two hours just talked or listened to other people talk, we might realize, just might, that we all have a lot more in common than we do differences. But people don't want to talk about that. Everybody, it's more comfortable for somebody to attack somebody else. You know why? Because then they don't have to face their own inadequacies in themselves. That's the other thing. We don't push personal responsibility. That's a big problem. Kids nowadays are taught you don't have to take, you know, responsibility for your actions. You don't have to take any responsibility for them. So, I mean, you see a kid, I've seen kids like literally knock things off a table and break it, and they'll go, "I didn't do it." Now, we had one or two of those when I was a kid, but they weren't as many as they are now. And when I was a kid, parents put that in check real quick. Nowadays, the parents, "Oh no, you know, Johnny, it's not your fault that the milk fell, that you swiped the glass over. You know, society, the pressures of society have given you anxiety. And you know, we need to lobby Congress to make laws that little kids shouldn't be pressured to drink milk because then they end up having an arm spasm and breaking the glass, and then someone in the house could get a cut foot, and they might get a disease or an infection from the cut on their foot. So in order to stave off somebody getting an infection from glass on their foot because somebody else in their house broke a glass of, you know, that was filled with milk because they were rageful at the milk and because society made them drink the milk, we need a law for that. No, you need to whoop your kid's rear end and teach him personal responsibility, okay? If the kid purposely is just swiping things off and breaking it, you got to teach them boundaries. And maybe you don't got to, you know, whoop them. You verbally do it. But you got to set boundaries for these kids. And it's got to be done. You really don't have a choice. When I was a kid, look, I know there's the whole nonviolent parenting movement. And I get it. I understand the whole concept and all that stuff. But kids need boundaries. Okay? Kids need boundaries. And right now, all those boundaries are being removed. Why do you think they push all the other stuff that they do? Why do you think they blur the lines no matter what? When there is a need for a distinction between something like, left or right, not the faux political paradigm, but for this example, your left and your right hand. I mean, now they're teaching kids that there is no difference between your left and your right hand. So they blur the lines. These kids are the future generations. What do you think they're doing that for? Easily controlled. Why do you think kids make fun of each other? I mean, kids are kids, but where do you think kids learn all that behavior from? Duh, their parents. And maybe the parents should put that in check. Teach the kid at an early age that you shouldn't pick on other people. You know, before I play this, as an example, when I was a kid, there was a period of time where I wasn't a bully, but I was starting down that path. And my mother grabbed me, and she smacked me across the mouth, and she told me no. She saw me picking on a kid, and she said, right in front of him, she smacked me across the mouth. She embarrassed me and told me no. And then when she took me home, she explained to me why she did that. She said she wanted the lesson to be ingrained into my head that that's wrong and that you don't treat people like that. And then she made sure she went out of her way. She went out of her way to make sure that I grew up learning how to treat people properly and not be a dick to other human beings, okay? Because she saw that, and she realized that some of it was from the people I was around and, you know, being in public school. She knew my mother wasn't stupid. So she went out of her way to make sure that her son wouldn't be a sociopath, you know, and that I would have emotion and that I would care about other human beings, okay? What they're doing now is the exact opposite of that. They want the future kids, the future generations to be more easily controlled, right? They have to use a ton of fear and all this manipulation. It gets exhausting to manipulate us. The younger generations, they're not going to have to continue to do all that because they can expedite the process and make it much easier and more efficient for them by just training the future generations to be brainwashed little zombies. That's how it works. Anyway, I want to get to the audio of this film. It's called, again, it's up on federaljack.com. It's called Guns and Weed, The Road to Freedom. Hopefully, after tonight, if you're still on the fence, if some of you think that, you know, we don't have, well, I'm a gun lover, but you pot smokers are crazy. Or if you're a pot smoker and you're like, well, I love smoking pot and, you know, but I'm not into guns and I'm not into violence. I'm okay, that's fine. But maybe you guys will realize that you have a lot in common. You know what the basic premise you guys have in common? Like Bill Cooper used to say, freedom. Freedom. Because without freedom, you can't play with your guns and you can't smoke your weed. Get it? Get it? Without freedom, you can't worship who you want to worship. Without freedom, you can't say, I think it's BS the government wants to take away my guns. See, without freedom, you don't have that option. It's called tyranny. Luckily for us, we have historical references to go back and look to. And you can look and say, oh, wow, that didn't work out. Makes you wonder why they teach the kids nothing about history anymore, huh? Because history is a roadmap. I know history is boring to some of you people, but you know what? It's not boring. History is the roadmap for the future. Well, how's that? Because you look back at history and you can say, well, I see how this ruler or this civilization or this person made a mistake, or even myself by looking, you know, if you look back into your own history, say, wow, I can see how mistakes were made and I can correct that behavior. What did Kennedy say? That an error only becomes a mistake when you refuse to correct it. Well, the history is like our roadmap. It's our instruction manual on how to fix the error so it does not become a mistake. So pay attention. This stuff, people, they manipulate all of us and get us arguing amongst each other so that we waste our time fighting each other. You know how much farther we'd be down the line? I mean, look what we've accomplished already, and we fight amongst ourselves. Can you imagine? You know, evolution of the mind wise, can you imagine, you know, where we'd be on the evolutionary scale, you know, in our consciousness if we weren't fighting amongst ourselves? So let's just stop. Well, it's not that simple. Yes, it is. Just like quitting smoking. It's not easy to quit smoking. You know what? I smoked for 15 years. It is easy to quit smoking. You have to decide to do it. Once you decide to do it and you make up your mind, I'm going to quit smoking, it's easy. I quit cold turkey. I smoked for 15 years, and I just said, nah, I'm done. because I made my mind up. If I can do it, you can do it. It's amazing what you can do when you put your mind to. Anyway, on to the film. Guns and Weed, The Road to Freedom. I'll drop the link in the chat room, and it's available to watch the full film. And I would suggest, even though you're going to hear the audio, go back and watch the film so you can see visually, too, and you can see who some of these different people are. You're going to hear from, you know, like, Sheriff Richard Mack is in here. You're going to hear from nurses. You're going to hear from patients. You're going to hear from attorneys, advocates. Just, you're going to hear from a litany of people. And there's a few cuss words, so just heads up. We're all adults. There's a few cuss words here and there, not many. It's not laced with vulgarity. But if you hear a cuss word here or there, you know, just kind of let it roll off your back. But I wanted to warn you ahead of time. These are adult topics. And, you know, the times we're in call for being adults, not being a bunch of, oh, my God, you said the S word. You know, like, calm down, everybody. I think we're all adults. I don't think anybody's going to melt into a puddle of ooze or wax just because we heard a swear word. So here we go. Guns and Weed, The Road to Freedom.
I wonder how prohibitionists would feel if they saw medical marijuana vastly improve the life of someone dear to them.
We're supposed to live under a form of government based on representation. If I don't have the right to kick in your door and kidnap you or take your property because you're smoking pot, then how is it that I can logically give that power, give that right to my representative?
As long as you're not hurting anybody else.
Land of the free.
The government has no more right to tell us what to put in our bodies than they have to take our guns or tell us what books we can read.
Hi, I'm Susan. I'm a 64-year-old grandmother and a retired RN and many other things. I have never used marijuana, but as a nurse, I am intrigued by the documented and clinical medical uses of it. And don't feel that there's any legitimate reason to prohibit that or any other medication.
They have to blur me on this because I'm a VA patient, and because it's still federally illegal, marijuana is, I have to protect my identity. Otherwise, if I'm positively identified, I lose all my federal benefits that I earned with my own blood. I was injured while serving in the Marine Corps in an incident with a helicopter and have had to use medical marijuana as a means of pain medication and to be able to sleep and function, period, because I've been left with no alternative from the people that are supposed to care for us, the Veterans Affairs.
This is my girlfriend right here. We've been together for 3 years now, and we were both diagnosed at the same time.
I've had 6 surgeries so far. And supposedly got about 4 or 5 more to go. I did go through a neglected surgery where they basically butchered me, not once but twice, and medically screwed me for the rest of my life.
For me, for having MS, it's just severe body pain, aches, OxyContin, all that stuff. It doesn't even give me bad side effects. It just doesn't even work. There's nothing I have ever found until I started using medical marijuana where it's just like relief.
The war on drugs is a war on people. It's a war on your daughters, your sons, your neighbors, your friends. It's a war on freedom and a war on those who would defend your freedom.
The medical marijuana, though, I've used that mostly because I've got issues with my back, a bunch of ruptured discs in my back, my left leg's partially paralyzed. I've got issues with my right arm and shoulder and paralysis. Parts were reattached. Make the airport fun now.
Medical marijuana for me has been like dang near a lifesaver because I have Crohn's disease and I have to deal with worrying about every piece of food I put in my body. And when I put a piece of food in my body that my Crohn's does not agree with, I get horrible, horrible stomach cramps. There's nothing else besides medical marijuana that takes these stomach cramps away.
The war on drugs is a war against everybody because they use that as a foothold to gain access to your car, to your home, to your business, to everything you do, all under the pretense of protecting society or yourself from illicit drug use. How many times do you even have a standard speeding ticket? The first thing out of an officer's mouth is, you don't mind if we search your car, do you? Or, where did that $10,000 come from that you've got? Unless you can prove to us where it came from, we're taking it. That might be drug money.
I don't believe the world would fall apart if drugs were legalized.
I don't think our society would collapse if marijuana was legal. I've been to Amsterdam 3 times. Loved it, obviously. Amsterdam is a clean, well-run, beautiful city. Everyone's professional, they're put together, they're organized.
The war on drugs leads directly to other mandates being crammed down our collective gullets.
In the case of England's disarmament, the general populace was convinced that if they just gave up these few rights, which they were led to believe were simply relics of a bygone age, that they would be safer and free from intrusion. In consequence, violent crime levels have skyrocketed in the United Kingdom. The police are now demanding closed-circuit television cameras in all public areas and some private areas. And now England is getting to the point where they have laws regulating the hot water temperature in your home.
Governments, state, local, and federal, are going broke in this country. A big reason is that we spend so much money incarcerating people. The vast majority of people behind bars in the United States are behind bars for nonviolent drug offenses, and by far the largest number of those are for marijuana-related offenses. Taking people who have not aggressed against anyone's natural rights, who have not harmed anyone, who have not stolen anything, we're throwing them behind bars, and then we're asking society to foot the bill.
Oh yeah, prisons would probably empty out. It would be a it would be a ghost town in those prisons if marijuana was ever legalized across the board.
It's really no different than the argument that a lot of conservatives like to make against welfare. You know, why should we have to pay for some deadbeat to pay his bills or to put food on the table or what have you? But they never stop to make the same argument for why should we have to pay to take care of some guy or some girl who committed no real crime to begin with and is now behind bars in a government cage that we're now paying for his livelihood outright, 100%, rather than just some food stamps.
My name is Austin. I am one of the owners here at Carmaceuticals. We are a local dispensary in Denver. We try to offer the highest quality, lowest price meds for our patients.
You are born with a right to use it because it grows just like a banana on a tree.
Another basic right we have is to put whatever we would like into our bodies as long as it's not hurting another person.
Mm-hmm. Freedom of ingestion is a basic human right.
The Lord said that what goes into a man's mouth is not what defiles him, but what comes out of it. For out of his mouth comes lies and hate.
Some of the first weapon restriction laws in the United States were passed in the South in the 1870s as a response to the freeing of recently enslaved African Americans. These laws were specifically designed to prevent freed slaves from possessing weapons while allowing the white landowner to maintain his power.
The Second Amendment to the United States Constitution says, a well-regulated militia being necessary to the security of a free state, the right of the people to keep and bear arms shall not be infringed. By the way, the phrase well-regulated does not mean under government control. At the time of its writing, it meant well-trained and with equipment in good condition. Supreme Court Justice Scalia clearly understood this when he recently wrote for the majority in Heller that the adjective well-regulated implies nothing more than the imposition of proper discipline and training.
The Second Amendment says you got to keep you and your gat intact.
To me, the Second Amendment means we always have an insurance policy. The Second Amendment is a guarantor of our right to say no.
And if you pick up any dictionary, the word no does not mean some or with the exception of or except as provided for by law. It means no. And any parent with kids knows that. What part of no don't you understand? Apparently, there's a part of no that our government does not understand.
Governments are like pushy parents. Do you want pushy parents?
I'm not a gun enthusiast. I'm not a hunter. I'm not a member of the NRA. But there's one thing that guns mean to me, and they represent freedom. Slaves and conquered peoples are not allowed to own guns, and I will never be in that group. and I don't want any other American to ever be in that group.
The only people who want to disarm you and take away those things which you wish to own are those who want to be your masters. And it doesn't matter whether they're from the government or from the PTA.
A citizen is a person with a gun. A peasant is a person without a gun.
A gun to me means I'm a free American. I would like to ask every politician who supports gun control, just what part of the Second Amendment don't you understand? Just what part of infringed don't you understand? And why is it that you, along with your bed partners of the NEA, try to rewrite American history and force your beliefs down the throats of our school students and tell them that the Second Amendment did not bestow or protect an individual right to keep and bear arms?
I'm going to pause it right there because the break's sneaking up. So far, it's a good documentary, right? Again, go over to federaljack.com. You can watch the full thing after the show later on. Guns and Weed, The Road to Freedom is the title. And I dropped the link in the chat room for anybody listening live. So if you're listening live and you're not by the chat, just run over and the link's in there. We'll be right back. Stay tuned. Freedom. We are back, ladies and gentlemen. Let's get right back into the documentary. Again, Guns and Weed, The Road to Freedom. You can find it over on federaljack.com. The link is in the chat room right now if you're listening live. So if you're not in the chat but you happen to be listening live, go over to Truth Frequency Radio, go to the chat room, or go over to federaljack.com and go to the Listen Live page in there. Both have access to the same chat room, and in the chat room is the link to the film, which is available to watch for free whenever you want on federaljack.com. Again, Guns and Weed, The Road to Freedom. Here we go.
Pick up any dictionary, the word no does not mean some or with the exception of or except as provided for by law. It means no. And any parent with kids knows that what part of no don't you understand? Apparently, there's a part of no that our government does not understand.
Governments are like pushy parents. Do you want pushy parents?
I'm not a gun enthusiast. I'm not a hunter. I'm not a member of the NRA. But there's one thing that guns mean to me, and they represent freedom. Slaves and conquered peoples are not allowed to own guns. And I will never be in that group. And I don't want any other American to ever be in that group.
The only people who want to disarm you and take away those things which you wish to own are those who want to be your masters. And it doesn't matter whether they're from the government or from the PTA.
A citizen is a person with a gun. A peasant is a person without a gun.
A gun to me means I'm a free American. I would like to ask every politician who supports gun control, just what part of the Second Amendment don't you understand? Just what part of infringed don't you understand? And why is it that you, along with your bed partners of the NEA, try to rewrite American history and force your beliefs down to our school students and tell them that the Second Amendment did not bestow or protect an individual right to keep and bear arms?
Teachers' unions have become a bad thing because they support the status quo of the slave camps, of the indoctrination centers.
Germany, the party in power at the time, the National Socialist Party, passed a law requiring all Jews to register their weapons. Shortly thereafter, they passed a law requiring Jews to surrender certain weapons. Law stacked on top of law until all Jews were legally forbidden to own weapons, eventually winding up in the concentration camps.
You get into a very slippery slope where you get into the Fuhrer principle, where people get it into their head that the government has the power to do whatever they want if it's for society's best interest or for someone's best interest or for some well-intended cause.
Politicians want to whittle away at our Second Amendment in order to protect themselves, so that when they begin to make policy that people would vociferously disagree with, there is no resistance. I believe it is so that when they finally attempt to put themselves in power indefinitely, no one has any way to stop them.
What do you think about guns and people being able to have guns?
I think that people have the right to protect themselves.
In Cambodia in 1975, Pol Pot restricted private ownership of weapons en route to the Khmer Rouge killing grounds. Joseph Stalin in the Soviet Union tried the same approach, restricted weapons possession for private folk, and shipped millions off to the gulag.
Anybody in authority wants to disarm honest people because they see themselves as being the person, the power, the person of all knowing, that they want to impose their values on everybody else. They feel it's a threat to their authority if honest people are allowed to carry a weapon for self-defense.
Could never happen in America. What about New Orleans, Hurricane Katrina aftermath, 2005, when the mayor, Ray Nagin, declared, "No one will be allowed to be armed. We are going to take all the guns." Shouldn't the aftermath of a natural disaster be the exact moment at which people need their weapons?
They want to be the ones with the guns. They don't want us to have the guns.
Guns for protection. Novel concept, America. I got news for you. It's only one thing you need to keep yourself safe. It's called a rape whistle. And I got them. My store. Only police can hear them.
I would ask people who say that their right to feel safe trumps my right to bear arms, would you not rather have the freedom to walk in any public place at any time that you desired?
These criminal gangs literally shooting it out in the streets, shooting up civilians, killing everyone, anyone in sight, just to make sure that they maintain a hold on their territorial monopoly.
Sheriff Richard Mack, former sheriff of Graham County, Arizona, retired now. I was an undercover narcotics officer, and I was a drug warrior. And fighting in the drug war actually taught me that the drug war is nothing but a farce.
A monopolist or a cartel, they've got a rather sweet deal, and it's not based on actually providing goods or services. It's based on their monopoly. And anytime someone wants to enter the market and try to break their monopoly, they have an incentive to stop that. And in the black market, the way that manifests is through violence.
Smoking weed is not an immoral act, but since it's illegal to get it, have it, and use it, people end up having to hang out with criminals.
In the past, procuring medicine was a nightmare for me. It was, you never knew what you were getting. It was usually just garbage.
And they get treated like criminals. Legalize weed, and the entire criminal aspect goes away.
Welcome to Carmaceuticals, man. Give you a little verbal tour here. Over in the back corner there, we carry our Dixie elixirs. We have medicated sodas, grape, strawberry, orange. We also carry, all as you can see in front of us, all of our edibles. We have gummies, lollipops, hard candies, chocolates, cookies, crispy treats. And then the big shebang, we got 55 strains of medical marijuana at any one time.
Drug cartels don't run liquor stores. If drugs were legalized tomorrow, drug lords would be out of a job.
The decisive vote of the 36th state against prohibition is happy news for the grain raisers of the United States and for many others throughout the land. With an eye on December 5th, work is being rushed in distilleries and bottling works. Thousands are being called back to work in plants of allied industry. At least 500,000 new jobs are predicted as the result of repeal. From keg and barrel factories, perhaps the most closely allied line, immediate benefits from repeal extend into almost every line of business and commerce. However, everyone's not waiting until December 15th. The lid is off in many places, with the downfall of prohibition being celebrated in real old-time hilarity. Yes, and by the renewal of old acquaintances. Hotels and nightclubs report a real pre-war spirit among those rebel killers.
Marijuana was outlawed in the U.S. in the 1930s from a combination of greed, fear, and racism. Alcohol prohibition had been tried and failed, so the nanny state do-gooders needed another crusade. Rumors were spread that blacks and Mexicans were trying to get white children hooked, even though marijuana is not addictive. A newspaper in 1934 reported, "Marijuana influences Negroes to look at white people in the eyes, step on white men's shadows, and look at a white woman twice." Billionaire newspaper owner William Randolph Hearst was heavily invested in paper production from trees and did not want to have hemp paper compete with his empire. Hearst used his newspapers as a bully pulpit, publishing prevarication like, "Marijuana is a shortcut to the insane asylum. Smoke marijuana cigarettes for a month and what once was your brain will be nothing but a storehouse of horrid specters. Hashish makes a murderer who kills for the love of killing out of the mildest mannered man who ever laughed at the idea that any habit could ever get him." A Montana paper reported, "When some beet-field peon takes a few traces of this stuff, he thinks he has just been elected president of Mexico, so he starts out to execute all his political enemies." Henry J. Anslinger, a careerist Fed goon and buddy of Hearst, basically became America's first drug czar by spinning tales like, "Most marijuana smokers in the U.S. are Negroes, Hispanics, Filipinos, and entertainers. Their satanic music, jazz, and swing result from marijuana use. This marijuana causes white women to seek sexual relations with Negroes, entertainers, and any others." The DuPont Chemical Company considered hemp a threat to their new patent, nylon, and also considered this plant that they could not patent, a plant that people could grow at home for free, a possible competitor to their pharmaceuticals. William Randolph Hearst and the DuPonts goaded their buddies in Congress to effectively outlaw pot with a Marijuana Tax Act in 1937. This was a bill that no one read and was passed in one very long, lie-filled session. The only resistance came from a congressman who wanted more information before voting because he didn't know what marijuana was. Most drug laws in the U.S. and our entire current war on drugs spring from the single day of big business hijacking Congress. Today, many cops who enforce pot laws do so only because it provides them with cushy jobs, good benefits, and a chance to push people around. And not many citizens know how marijuana became illegal. They just think, the government knows best. Pot must be bad, or it wouldn't be illegal.
Uh-oh! There'll be no more scenes such as this. Barrel after barrel of prize whiskeys destroyed by government agents. It's going to be a cold winter for the barrel busters.
We're here for our patients. We keep our prices low. $43 an eighth is the maximum for our members, and we have a daily special every day it changes. We have $38 eighths as well.
Thomas Jefferson wrote in the Declaration of Independence of the concept of inalienable rights to life, liberty, and property. How can you possibly defend your life, liberty, and property in today's age without a gun?
The Second Amendment does not grant rights. The Second Amendment merely guarantees a right that already exists.
Documents don't grant rights. They declare rights. The Bill of Rights could be outlawed tomorrow, and you'd still have those rights. They're in you. You're born with them. They're innate.
If the Second Amendment were repealed, it wouldn't change our innate right to defend ourselves. Because it's an innate right. Merely stating on paper that something is or isn't so does not change the reality.
The Second Amendment did not yet exist on April 19, 1775. But the patriots at Lexington and Concord knew they didn't need permission.
The federal government likes to quote the Supremacy Clause. Maybe they ought to read it, because the Supremacy Clause does not say that the federal government is supreme. Far from it. It says only those laws made in pursuance of the Constitution are supreme.
Well, natural rights are the rights that you're born with. Like any animal on this planet, you have the right to defend yourself, the right to eat, to drink, to stay alive.
All creatures have innate abilities to defend themselves, be it through teeth, claws, the ability to camouflage themselves.
What's under your shirt?
I have a level 3A bullet-resistant vest on.
When you know, as a potential criminal, that every person around you is possibly armed, probably armed, you're a lot less likely to mug grandma on the street corner than if you know that no one around has a gun and you do. It's already recognized that when you pass laws restricting gun ownership, the law-abiding people who you don't necessarily have to worry about are the only ones that are going to follow that law. The people who are going to be out running around mugging grandmother, robbing stores, doing those sort of things that involve a gun, they're already willing to break the law, so what's breaking one more law to them?
Article 1, Section 7 of the Wyoming State Constitution says that, quote, "absolute, arbitrary power over the lives, liberty, and property of free men exists nowhere in a republic, not even in the largest majority," unquote.
as far as I'm concerned, nobody gives you those rights. You're born with those rights as being part of nature.
I don't have to be worried about cops pulling up and arresting me or scaring me or, you know, having something on my record, letting my grandma down. I don't get in trouble, and I never have. I am a good girl.
If 99% of the country voted to make eating ice cream illegal, it wouldn't make eating ice cream wrong.
Machine. Gertie, it's Hetty. Hi, hun. I was wondering, is your son home from college yet? This chemo, it's just making me sick, and that stuff he got me last time really helped, and, you know, I could sleep, I could eat. I need some help here, and I'm really hoping that you're there soon, and he's there, and would you call me, please, hon? I'm just beside myself.
If my mom's friend is ailing from something, and she calls me up 2,000 miles away and says, do you know of anything that can help? And the answer I have right now is write your congressman.
A crime proper has been often defined as a debt in which one party had no say over the terms. If I steal your wallet, that means that technically I owe you the contents of your wallet, but you didn't have any say over us making that agreement. I just took your stuff. If I assault you, then I've caused you harm. I owe you compensation. You didn't have any say over that. If I sit in my living room and smoke a joint, I'm not causing any harm to any other person. I'm not causing any harm to anyone else's property. So then from there, where does the debt come in? Who do I owe in compensation for having smoked that joint? Whereas again, if I steal your stuff, if I assault you, if you know, I violate your privacy, then I've aggressed against someone's natural rights.
We should never consider ourselves doing something good for our community and that we're actually serving people because we warehouse people with drug problems in these prisons. We don't even keep drugs out of them.
They say the definition of insanity is trying the same thing over and over and expecting different results. This is certainly the case with the United States and its continued war on drugs.
Prohibition hasn't made people quit smoking pot any more than a total gun ban would make a free man hang his head in shame and voluntarily turn all his hardware in to the federal smelter.
The people that we've elected into these offices to run this thing have, I think, turned our country into more of a police state than anything. We're, you know, a lot of people in this country worry about us heading towards socialism. I think we're closer to communism now. The way the laws are changing, they're heading that direction. And, you know, that's not what I served for.
The 10th Amendment to the United States Constitution says, the powers not delegated to the United States by the Constitution, nor prohibited by it to the states, are reserved to the states respectively, or to the people.
What the federal government would have us ignore is that the 10th Amendment secures all rights not expressly granted to the federal government to the states and people at large.
Many laws and taxation are enforced at the point of a gun because that's really the only recourse a government has. Let's say you don't pay your property taxes on your home. The government will send people to your house to try to collect on those taxes. If you tell those people you're not paying your taxes, they send other people that are armed. When you tell those people to go away, they point guns at your head. If you still resist, they have been known to shoot you. Generally, the use of the gun is enough to intimidate someone into putting their hands behind their back, in which they put handcuffs on you and take you to jail and then take your property.
I never understood why some people hate cops and hate guns, but demand the government enforce peaceful, utopian agendas when the government enforces those agendas with cops who have guns.
The federal government would have us forget that our Constitution expressly limits what they can do. Our Constitution tells the government what it is allowed to do.
Statists on both sides always think we're about three laws from perfection. Nanny staters are nanny staters, whether they've got their left boot or their right boot on your neck.
One of the problems with having Democrats in power is that they're in love with this idea of civil liberties, but they don't understand that you can't have civil liberties without economic liberties. And vice versa, the Republicans are in love with their version of economic liberty, but they don't understand that you cannot have economic liberty without civil liberties, that they're really two halves of the same concept or two sides of the same coin.
People who support one section of our Bill of Rights while ignoring the rest are hypocrites, because the Bill of Rights is not something that you can pick and choose from at will. Rights support each other.
The war on drugs fuels the war on guns. Look how the government wanted to disarm honest citizens in the U.S. by trying to reinstate the scary black rifle ban to help the war on drugs in Mexico.
You cannot outlaw drugs and still claim to be pro-free market. Outlawing or prohibition is the most stringent form of regulation that there is. Conversely, you cannot have civil liberties on the Democrat side and be against ownership of guns. How is one to possibly defend their civil liberties if they don't have the weaponry and the means to do so?
Our right to free speech allows us to protest when other rights are threatened. Our right to bear arms allows us physical defense of those rights. Our right to trial by jury allows us to be heard by our peers rather than silenced by a government.
And the war on guns fuels the war on drugs. When you outlaw things instead of actions, honest people are treated like criminals.
I have been arrested one time for marijuana. It was before all the Amendment 20. They threw the book at me.
Our justice system has been replaced with a system of numbers. And the prosecutors want to increase their win-loss records, and police want to have their conviction rates maintained. And it's all at the expense of the justice system in general. It's at the expense of the people.
Numerous parties that benefit from the war on drugs. There are the distributors of drugs who enjoy artificially large profits that are not based on real market mechanisms. They're based on risk premiums. Also, you have prison workers unions. They have a very large lobbying presence, especially in Washington, D.C. and at various state legislatures. Of course, marijuana possession is the number one reason for packing prisons full of inmates and demanding the building of more prisons. So obviously, if you're in the field of prison work, you want to see more people incarcerated. Prosecutors get to enjoy a tough on crime, tough on drugs, artificial moral high ground when it comes time to campaign.
We now live in a culture where law enforcement believes that their ultimate goal is to rid our community of drugs. Sheriffs run for office on that platform. Oh, I'll get rid of drugs and we're going to be zero tolerance and we're going to get all these people out of here and they're going to leave your kids alone and we're going to clean up the streets.
Politicians, same story. They can enjoy a pseudo tough on crime stance without having to actually go after real criminals. And there's an army of lawyers in this country who actually make their living off public defender work. A large majority of people who go to court on drug charges can't pay for their own legal defense. Take away the war on drugs, and a lot of the indigent defendants aren't in court anymore and don't need public defenders. Nanny laws and taxation are always enforced at the barrel of the gun. It is generally the job of the politicians and the political class to make sure that citizens don't see that they don't understand that.
A government can write laws until they run out of paper or run out of ink. But unless they're willing to pick up a gun and put someone in a cage for breaking those laws are really just suggestions.
If somebody ever comes around you talking to you about drugs, run away from me.
There are no good cops. There are good peace officers. There are men and women who honestly understand self-ownership and honestly understand the necessity for people to be responsible for themselves.
And see, this is an unloaded gun. This is a Glock 40. Okay, I'm the only one in this room professional enough that I know of to carry a Glock 40. I'm the only
one. Unfortunately, they are few and far between. The rest of them are cops who have bought into the false assumption that they are some sort of a special breed and have special privileges and are immune from the laws of non-aggression.
I've seen it far too many times where plea bargain systems have worked like this. Some poor sap arranges to where somebody can get some meth. He needs $50, so he does it. He gets caught holding the meth, and they say, well, we're going to charge you with about 7 or 8 felonies. You could be looking at 15 to 20 years. Or if you just plead to one felony, we'll give you 2.5 years in prison. And he ends up thanking everybody. And that guy shouldn't be spending a day in jail.
No one's ever OD'd from marijuana. Alcohol kills thousands and thousands every year.
Pharmaceutical companies are pretty upset about this, so I'm sure they're behind a lot of leading the fight against medical marijuana.
Pot isn't harmful, but it stays illegal because there's too much money in keeping it illegal. Big medicine, big alcohol, big government, big prison industry, they all feed off the war on drugs.
If they make it criminal, you have to deal with the criminals.
We are spinning our wheels, wasting our time, wasting our money, and creating another branch of Big Brother government. I'm fed up with it. It's doing no good. And if my choice is continuing as we are with this ridiculous drug war or ending prohibition, then I'm all for ending prohibition. Prohibition doesn't work.
The only role of government is to coordinate those rules that people agree to and wish to live by.
I want to know what this government's going to do to fix up my driveway.
Take care of your own damn driveway. The government can only do things by stealing the money from someone else. The government has no money of its own. They can only borrow it, counterfeit it, or steal it at gunpoint with more and more taxes.
Nanny laws are all those laws that politicians just love to enforce upon us regarding victimless crimes. Too often these days, I see so many against smoking. Oh, I was forced to go into a restaurant and there was smoke in there and I couldn't escape. And now we're all gonna die. And you know, all these ridiculous laws where there is no victim, but somebody wants to make sure that you don't have a couch sitting on your front deck.
I'm gonna pause it right there, ladies and gentlemen. Top of the hour break coming up. We come back in for hour two. I'm just going to give it a quick hour two intro, and then we're going to get right back into it for time purposes so I can fit the rest of the audio in. Do not go anywhere. We will be right back. Again, you can watch the full documentary on federaljack.com, Guns and Weed, The Road to Freedom. So one thing we all have in common. We have a lot more in common, but it's one thing we can all grasp onto. Freedom! We'll be right back. Ladies and gentlemen, we are back with hour number two here on tonight's live edition of Down the Rabbit Hole. I am your host, Popeye, from FederalJack.com. It is February 19th, 2014, Wednesday edition of DTRH. Tonight I am playing a documentary called Guns and Weed, The Road to Freedom. You can watch the full documentary over on FederalJack.com if you're just joining us in the second hour. Full documentary available over on federaljack.com. Go in the search bar, type in guns and weed. Full documentary will come up. You can watch it there. Streaming right from my server. And I think there's even a link to download the movie if you want to watch it for yourself later on. I believe I have the link there. And there's a link to the filmmaker's website and everything else on there too. But it's all there. Look up Guns and Weed, The Road to Freedom. It's right on federaljack.com if you want to watch it. And if you're listening live, you can go over to the chat, and I will drop it again in a few minutes into the chat room. I'll give it a few minutes for people that are listening and might want to run to their computer. Maybe they're listening on a mobile device or something. If you're not in the chat room, go to the chat room really quick. You don't have to stay and chat. Some people do, some people don't. But I use it as a way to drop links and stuff to you also. I will drop the link to the full movie so you can watch it in full length. As I said, I did cut out in the first hour. I said I did cut out a few things here and there, but none of the audio of any information. It was just it's a documentary and it's a creative way that they did things. So there was a couple skits where they had some music and stuff, and I took that out because you would have needed to see the visual to understand what was going on with the audio. And radio, you can't see video, right? Kind of don't have to explain the basics of that one. So that's why I'm telling you, you can go watch the full video again after you hear it here. I hope this just, the point of the radio show of why I'm doing this is to get everybody to understand that we all have the same things in common. I'm trying to knock down that barrier of, you know, you're this and I'm that. And it's on so many levels. I'm trying to knock down those barriers. I'm trying to get people to see through them because they're not even real. They're created only in our minds. And that stuff's programmed into us. I could get into it. Anyway, go back and listen to the first hour because I ranted about why I was getting into this and playing this. But you can watch the full video over at federaljack.com. Guns and Weed, The Road to Freedom. Here we go.
Only role of government is to coordinate those rules that people agree to and wish to live by.
I want to know what this government's going to do to fix up my driveway.
Take care of your own damn driveway. The government can only do things by stealing the money from someone else. The government has no money of its own. They can only borrow it, counterfeit it, or steal it at gunpoint with more and more taxes.
Nanny laws are all those laws that politicians just love to enforce upon us regarding victimless crimes. Too often these days, I see so many against smoking. Oh, I was forced to go into a restaurant and there was smoke in there and I couldn't escape. And now we're all going to die. And you know, all these ridiculous laws where there is no victim, but somebody wants to make sure that you don't have a couch sitting on your front deck or an old washing machine in the back, when in fact it's your own private property.
Anytime you prohibit any kind of transaction, whether it be drugs or milk or automobiles or what have you, you develop a black market.
A lot of the times dealing with a drug dealer, you have to deal with kind of shady people sometimes. You have to deal with people who are not good people, people who are out to get you.
And in that black market, you get a gigantic source of revenue based purely on the willingness to take the risk in breaking the law to provide whatever it is that has been outlawed.
Someone's cutting in on their market or cutting in their territory. It could spur a drug war, it could spur an assassination, all sorts of violence and crime.
You walk in here, it's like going to a pharmacy.
Yeah, exactly. It's like going to your pharmacy.
Here, if someone does something better, or if someone opens up next door to us, what do? We up our quality. We come up with new ways to lower prices. We have to get our creativity thinking, not instead of our anger and our blood.
We throw a Karma Cola contest. We have competitions all the time. Give away free meds to everyone. Right now, this month, we're doing the Karma Cola contest. We have three of our signature strains. The middle one is our Grape 8. On the left is the Wiz, and on the right is our Pop Special. We also have two joints, some keef, some hash, and some hash oil. This is all being raffled away the day before Halloween, so someone's going to have one of the best Halloweens of their life. Every day, we also give away free medicine to our patients to kind of help them out, keep the cost low. We have games. Sometimes we draw cards. Sometimes you guess the song playing when you enter. We also have free Gram Friday, free T-shirt Friday.
When you're dealing with a drug dealer, they are not giving you the true deal.
When you have black markets, you don't have any kind of legal recourse through the court system for incidents of fraud or bad business practices.
They are not giving you the quantity for the price or the quality you've paid for.
So whereas in any normal above-the-board business, if a person does not conduct themselves in a socially acceptable manner, there's repercussions. Customers can sue. In the black market, you don't have those recourse. The only recourse is violence. The only thing you can do, if someone rips off your stash, the only thing you can do is kick in their door and try to get it back or shoot them. The drug trade becomes such a lucrative field because you're not really selling drugs. What you're selling is the willingness to take that risk to provide the drugs. The more people you have taking that risk, the less potential profit there is to be derived from it. So there's an incentive for these drug dealers, these criminal gang leaders, to take each other out. The war on drugs is unwinnable for numerous reasons, the first one being basic supply and demand. Anytime you have a demand for anything, a supply will evolve to satisfy that. It's been shown throughout history, whether people have tried to ban prostitution, drug use, guns, alcohol. Just because you make something illegal doesn't mean that people stop desiring it.
Where there's a will, there's a way. Find the hole.
All that you end up doing is pushing that desire underground where it mixes with other seedy elements of society and creates the crime that becomes associated with it.
I mean, the number one mistake people make maybe once in their lives, at least when trying to buy marijuana, is I gave my money to the dealer or whoever the guy was, and he said he would be right back.
and he never came back.
The black market is kind of starting to diminish a bit. There's no longer the shady behind the back alley, hand a bag over, hand some cash over. Now it's open. We're here.
I mean, we don't have criminal gangs shooting each other up in the streets over alcohol distribution. I mean, that was a rather common occurrence in the big cities during the 1920s. I have yet to see a Budweiser truck shooting it out with a Miller Lite truck.
You can see exactly what we're doing. There's nothing hidden in it. It's not laced with anything. It's just removing all the sketchiness.
We've been fighting this drug war for 40 years. We spend $70 billion a year. And what have we done? Drugs are more prevalent, they're more potent, and the rate of abuse is just as high as it ever was.
The harder you crack down, the more draconian you make the penalties, really all you end up doing is creating more monetary value to go into that risk-based incentive. It's kind of a vicious cycle in that you crack down, you raise the profits involved in selling, so then more people want to get involved, so then you have the violence associated with trying to maintain a monopoly and trying to maintain those artificially high profit levels. And so because of the violence, then you have to crack down even more, which only further inflates the profit level involved in delivering the substances. And it's an unwinnable battle.
Depending on the legislation, of course, we're hoping that it becomes kind of a free enterprise, if you will. Anyone can join, anyone can open up a center, anyone that can do it better. Competition the American way is a beautiful thing. If they try to shut it down and make it really hard to enter this market, then the quality is going to decrease. Prices are going to increase, and that's going to hurt the patient.
And now we're actually giving cancer patients medication for free. If you go to any of the dispensaries and you're lined up and you're actually a true cancer patient, most of these people actually help you out, unlike a pharmaceutical doctor that'll just run you through for copays every week.
Well, my name is Eric Underwood, and I'm just the bio engineer here of this soda.
As an engineer, I find many firearms to be fascinating pieces of machinery.
Specifically designed it for, I'm a patient also, and it's basically what I, for my ailments and pains, and had developed it.
The intricacies of their design, the skill with which they have been crafted, particularly antique weapons, is something that I kind of marvel at.
Yeah, I would say I have a passion for this.
Hard drugs are no different than guns or marijuana or anything else.
I don't think that people should take drugs, but I also don't think that the government should interfere with it.
They are substances that people may choose to use or even abuse. If there is no coercion, theft, fraud involved, no one has any right to question it.
Should race cars be outlawed? How about boxing, skydiving, camping in bear country? Those things are like drugs. Voluntarily doing something dangerous and exhilarating for kicks.
I really don't care what my neighbor does on the other side of this fence, just as long as it doesn't bother me and I don't have to pay for it.
I think people are born with the right to exist. I think people are born with the right to practice whatever religion, faith, or values that are their own, as long as it doesn't mess with anyone else. I think those are rights that you're born with, and I think everything else is earned after that.
She has a full-time job at a hotel, and I have a full-time job as tiling.
Yeah.
And we both vote.
I feel there definitely is still lots of people that are against it, but here in Colorado at least, there's so many patients every day getting their medical marijuana cards, so many patients turning away from prescription pills and whatnot. It's kind of a growing surge. Activism's huge.
Do you think that legalizing marijuana would help the economy in any way?
I'm working right now.
Being a little elf, though, yeah, I come in whenever I have free time. I trim up their buds so that we get all the big leaves off, and then they dry them for a couple days, and then they sell them to the patients that want it.
The medical marijuana industry is creating tons of jobs if they allow it to.
You can fail or make it. That's what America does for you.
Mm-hmm.
The generation between the baby boomers and Generation X that actually see the whole picture.
A lot of the generation that's kind of in charge right now, they were a part of the whole, you know, weed is this awful, terrible drug that's going to make you crazy and make you kill your whole family if you smoke it.
If I tried to talk to my grandmother about this, she'd say, no, that's what the cows eat. You know, you don't go and smoke what the cows eat.
Some of the patients that come in here, you know, they're in their 50s and 60s and 70s, and they say, you know, we've been waiting so long for this day when we could go into a store and buy marijuana. You know, they can't believe it. So I have a gut feeling that when I'm 65 or so, I'll be saying the same thing to the next generation, and I'll be saying, I can't believe it. It's legal all over America. This is unbelievable. I've been waiting my whole life.
Gun lovers, those of us who enjoy carrying and using guns, should support those who want to use marijuana or any other plant, simply because all of our rights spring from the same source, and the abrogation of anyone's rights abrogates all of them.
I believe that when the cartridge box is no longer available, the ballot box has very little meaning.
I don't believe the war on drugs is winnable whatsoever. They've been fighting this for years, spending, hundreds of billions of dollars, infringing our liberties, our privacy, and what has it brought us? Not one step closer.
I was out on the streets. I lived in the drug culture. I was very successful in buying drugs from criminals or drug dealers. And if there's anything I learned is that these people are just like you and me. They're good people. They've got some habits that need addressing.
The government will never win the war on drugs, primarily because they don't want to.
Even if we did want to stop all drug use, I don't believe it can be possibly done.
The war on drugs serves as an excuse for unbelievable amounts of coercion, theft, murder, and control. And since control is their primary purpose in life, they have no interest in winning the war, because that would mean the end of it, and they would lose all of their advantage.
Okay, there are definitely differences between a good cop and a bad cop. To me, the old Andy Griffith was the typical good cop. He was a peace officer. Nowadays, too often, we have law enforcement officers who are only concerned with enforcing the law as it is on the books, regardless of what makes sense or any common judgment regarding the situation. Most cops are good. Most cops are my friend. There are a few bad ones.
How do you answer people who say, oh, it might make you want to kill your neighbors or do all sorts of bad things?
Prove it. I haven't seen that yet.
You haven't killed your neighbors yet?
No, I haven't killed the neighbors over marijuana, not at all.
Nah, he just gets any question.
Would you like a receipt?
Sure, why not?
Play the game?
Sure.
Cool. The game today is pick a pull up. So you pick what card you're going to pull out of the deck. Number one, letter.
Eight.
Eight?
Eight.
So yeah, we're going for a free gram of hash. Pop special hash.
I'll take the top one.
Damn. Whew. Oh, don't worry. We're going to close.
I need work. All right. Appreciate it.
Enjoy. See you later.
Soon.
I don't see this causing a problem. It's actually helping the whole economy. And if we actually industrialized hemp, we could actually maybe save the planet.
When you allow one right to be taken away, then the others just follow naturally, like a bunch of dominoes falling down. Once they see that right being taken away, let's say the right to smoke, and pretty soon it's the, you know, smoking pot or owning firearms or having any other pleasure in your life. Any one thing leads to the next one, going down the tubes.
All laws that prohibit peaceful behavior are illegitimate and stupid.
At the end of 2010, medical marijuana is legal in 15 states and the District of Columbia. Yet pot is still illegal at the federal level. Medical marijuana dispensaries were routinely raided and closed by feds with guns drawn through much of George Bush's administration and well into Obama's first year. At this moment, jackbooted thugs have stopped raiding the marijuana health centers, apparently respecting the state's rights under the 10th Amendment. Yet the feds are trampling attempts by states within the 10th Amendment with regards to guns. Alaska, Montana, Idaho, Wyoming, Utah, Arizona, Tennessee, and South Dakota have passed Firearms Freedom Acts, which declare the right to manufacture firearms and ammunition for use and sale only within that particular state without federal interference or regulation. The Wyoming law even allows for the arrest and prosecution of federal agents violating that law. In response to this legislation, the feds have sent warnings to gun sellers in these states, threatening their licenses to sell in other states, in essence, threatening their very livelihoods. The feds refuse to recognize the states' rights to pass these laws, claiming the Commerce Clause in the Constitution prohibits this. This is a gross misappropriation of the intent of the Commerce Clause, which was intended to encourage commerce between the states, not give the feds ultimate control over all commerce. 17 other states have introduced firearms freedom legislation. Many U.S. states recognize concealed carry weapons permits from other states, but only 3 states, Montana, Michigan, and Rhode Island, recognize medical marijuana permits from other states. So if a patient drives from Colorado to Montana, she would not legally be permitted to possess her medicine while passing through Wyoming. If she travels a lot for business, she'd either have to go without medical marijuana for extended periods of time, or put herself in constant risk by attempting to take her medicine with her. In Alaska, Arizona, and Vermont, a permit is not required to carry a concealed gun. In Wyoming, Colorado, Arizona, Montana, and 33 other states, concealed carry gun permits are shall issue. Any mentally sound, non-felon adult can get one, yet a small amount of marijuana is a serious crime in some of these states, and most have no provision for medical marijuana, even if you're dying a painful death of cancer. These government permission slips for guns and pot also cost money. This randomly applied tax violates several sections of the Constitution. A concealed carry permit is nearly impossible to get in Los Angeles or San Francisco, unless you're a judge or a movie star. Yet there, medical marijuana cards are practically shall issue. Just about any adult who wants one can get one. But possession of a gun in public without a permit is a serious felony. You can walk around Wyoming with a loaded gun on your hip without a permit, but they'll throw you in prison for a year or more for a few grams of pot. In California, possession of a small amount of pot is a misdemeanor, or even the equivalent of a simple traffic ticket. In November 2010, a ballot initiative to legalize all pot possession for personal use failed in California. The vote was 53.9% against. Before the vote, Los Angeles County Sheriff Lee Baca said he'd continue to bust people for marijuana possession, even if pot had become legal at the state level. Obama-appointed Attorney General Eric Holder had the same plan, acting under pressure from the President of Mexico. But if you walk around San Francisco or Los Angeles with a gun on your hip, you'd likely end up with cops or even SWAT throwing you to the ground, putting a gun to your head, and taking you to prison. These issues are further confused by the fact that private firearm ownership is legal nationwide. The right to keep and bear arms is clearly protected by the Second Amendment. While we believe that freedom of ingestion is a basic human right, at this time it is not clearly stated in the law. The overreach of the feds is invasive, harmful, and applied in a seemingly random way. The capriciousness of various states in allowing or denying firearm freedoms is confusing and puts good folks at risk. Furthermore, none of this protects anyone from anything and only ruins the lives of honest people. The feds seem to resent the Constitution, feel it gets in their way. Their continued failure to recognize individual freedoms will turn our country into a bleak and unlivable police state. And all states need to recognize their citizens' natural rights if America is to keep from sliding into a totalitarian hell.
Private versions of the FDA, the SEC, and all of the alphabet soup government agencies would evolve. You can see this already with things like Consumer Reports. Consumer Reports goes out and tests products and says, these are the safe products. These are the products that have defects. These are the products that you should stay away from. You would see a lot more of these private agencies evolve in the marketplace, and what would happen is they would have to compete with each other based on the credibility of their information. In the private market, these consumer reports type of agencies would have a market incentive to guarantee the integrity of the information that they produce. Otherwise, word would get out that they produce bunk information or that they can be bought off. That damages their credibility. People stop going to that agency. One of the other problems with government regulatory bodies or government consumer protection bodies is that every time they screw up, the excuse is always that they didn't have enough money, they didn't have enough manpower. FDA misses the boat on drug safety, so they get a bigger budget. In the private world, it doesn't work that way. If you fail to do your job, you get fired. And if a private consumer reports agency, if they fail to do their job, they go out of business. Taxes were unconstitutionally used to outlaw marijuana and enact forms of gun control because the people who wanted to achieve this knew that they did not have a constitutional route for doing so. They came up with the idea that there are just certain things in society that are too important for the Constitution to get in the way. So what they did was they said that you can have your marijuana, you can have your firearms, but they're taxed and you have to have this stamp proving that you've paid the tax. And then they conveniently issued no stamps. It would be synonymous today with state legislatures saying that you can possess cigarettes if they have the little stamp that's on the bottom of every pack that they have today, but then they conveniently get rid of the stamps that prove that the tax was paid.
Taxation is sometimes referred to as theft because it involves the taking of property where both sides do not voluntarily agree. Taxation cannot happen without coercion.
When I buy something from a provider, that provider is voluntarily agreeing to give me whatever I'm buying from them, and I'm voluntarily agreeing to relinquish my money in exchange for what they're giving me. When it comes to taxation, that voluntary exchange does not exist. The government decides that you will pay X amount of dollars for X service. However, this doesn't involve a bargaining process between the government and the person being taxed. It's just the government saying so.
I have seen the partners of the company have to spend a lot of money paying the state tons of money just to stay open, basically.
Taxation is essentially taking property from you. It doesn't matter that they're promising to provide a service. It would still be theft if I knocked on your door and promised to protect you from vandals and then demanded money for it. The mafia does this and it's called a protection racket. But when the government does it, it's called public service.
We do have to pay sales tax as we are sales license. The state finally required all dispensaries, grow operations, as well as edible centers to apply. And for us, that costed around $7,500. And then we also have two grow centers as well, which are $1,250 each. And every year we're supposed to be paying and applying to become a dispensary as well. So that's going to be like $10,000 every year. And the more patients you have, the more you have to pay. Three different brackets. And the top one is $18,500.
I'm going to pause it right there because the break's coming up. You see how much money could be made by these state governments, these people that push the fear, oh my God, we need to have more cops. If you smoke pot, you're supporting Osama bin Laden. Ah! Whether it be state governments, local governments, federal government. Look how much money could be made. All this financial problems that they have. We have such a shortfall of cash and oh my God. It's never, by the way, it's never the spending, right? I'd never look at that. But we have such a shortfall of cash. What about all the tax money you guys could make on this? No. Scourge of evil. Freedom. No control. We're not puppets.
Private versions of the FDA, the SEC, and all of the alphabet soup government agencies would evolve. You can see this already with things like Consumer Reports. Consumer Reports goes out and tests products and says, these are the safe products. These are the products that have defects. These are the products that you should stay away from. You would see a lot more of these private agencies evolve in the marketplace, and what would happen is they would have to compete with each other based on the credibility of their information. In the private market, these Consumer Reports type of agencies would have a market incentive to guarantee the integrity of the information that they produce. Otherwise, word would get out that they produce bunk information or that they can be bought off. That damages their credibility. People stop going to that agency. One of the other problems with government regulatory bodies or government consumer protection bodies is that every time they screw up, the excuse is always that they didn't have enough money, they didn't have enough manpower. FDA misses the boat on drug safety, so they get a bigger budget. In the private world, it doesn't work that way. If you fail to do your job, you get fired. And if a private consumer reports agency, if they fail to do their job, they go out of business. Taxes were unconstitutionally used to outlaw marijuana and enact forms of gun control because the people who wanted to achieve this knew that they did not have a constitutional route for doing so. They came up with the idea that there are just certain things in society that are too important for the Constitution to get in the way. So what they did was they said that you can have your marijuana, you can have your firearms, but they're taxed and you have to have this stamp proving that you've paid the tax. And then they conveniently issued no stamps. It would be synonymous today with state legislatures saying that you can possess cigarettes if they have the little stamp that's on the bottom of every pack that they have today, but then they conveniently get rid of the stamps that prove that the tax was paid.
Taxation is sometimes referred to as theft because it involves the taking of property where both sides do not voluntarily agree. Taxation cannot happen without coercion.
When I buy something from a provider, that provider is voluntarily agreeing to give me whatever I'm buying from them, and I'm voluntarily agreeing to relinquish my money in exchange for what they're giving me. When it comes to taxation, that voluntary exchange does not exist. The government decides that you will pay X amount of dollars for X service. However, this doesn't involve a bargaining process between the government and the person being taxed. It's just the government saying so.
I have seen the partners of the company have to spend a lot of money paying the state tons of money just to stay open, basically.
Taxation is essentially taking property from you. It doesn't matter that they're promising to provide a service. It would still be theft if I knocked on your door and promised to protect you from vandals and then demanded money for it. The mafia does this and it's called a protection racket. But when the government does it, it's called public service.
We do have to pay sales tax as we have a retail sales license. The state finally required all dispensaries, grow operations, as well as edible centers to apply. And for us, that costed around $7,500. And then we also have two grow centers as well, which are $1,250 each. And every year we're supposed to be paying and applying to become a dispensary as well. So that's going to be like $10,000 every year. And the more patients you have, the more you have to pay. Three different brackets. And the top one is $18,500. Kind of money-heavy industry. Okay. The state wants their chunk. Every patient has to also pay $90 to the state in order to be on the registry. So that's just to get medicine. In order to help you, you have to pay $90 just to the state, just for them to agree that you might need that medicine.
Taxation through citation is mine. And I made it up a long time ago, because a long time ago I got sick and tired of the taxation that is being dished out by our patrol officers all across this country. You highway patrol officers that sit there and write 15, 20, 25 tickets a day, you're doing nothing but being a tax collector. That's a tax on the people. It is ridiculous. It's a violation of the Eighth Amendment. And you, sir, you, Mr. Peace Officer, you swore an oath to uphold and defend the United States Constitution. Yet you think you can violate that Constitution without any repercussion and yet issue these tickets all day long to people who haven't done anything close to what you have done in violating your oath. That's perjury.
No, I don't mind the government checking my emails on the interwebs, tapping my phone and whatnot. I mean, they're just keeping me safe from drug dealers, terrorists.
You hate authority, but you love government. You hate cops, but you love government. What the fuck?
And anybody on the conservative right side, I assume they all build bombs and live in shacks and write manifestos.
Democrats want to melt your guns. Republicans want to burn your books. Democrats want to take away your internet and your pot. Republicans want to take away your dildos and your pot.
Of course we need the government. Without them, how else would we have electricity? Or running water? Or air to breathe? Or, I mean, how else would we solve forcibly the injustices of the world?
We'd solve the problems with the opposite of force. With free thought. With free markets. And free men.
But.
In the absence of government regulatory bodies, it's still possible to get clean water, clean air, non-toxic food. I mean, human beings received these things, they found these things for thousands of years before the FDA came along.
Had I had to keep taking the narcotics that they kept prescribing me over and over again, I wouldn't be able to function. I wouldn't be able to talk to you right now, because right now I would think there were six of you standing in front of me.
If the government was not involved in their regulatory business, there would be a lot more competition in the marketplace. Take the FDA, for example. Any player in the game who can't afford to jump through the FDA's hoops, who can't afford to hire all of the lawyers involved and play the game, their drugs don't make it to the market.
See, they won't allow her to have medical marijuana, but they'll allow her to put interferon in her body. Uh-huh. Interferon is a very, very harsh drug that goes throughout the whole entire body and physically changes the whole entire body.
Whereas without those, consumers would be much more informed. They wouldn't be relying on an FDA seal of approval, which means they wouldn't be buying dangerous drugs like Vioxx that ended up causing serious health problems, but was considered acceptable because it had the FDA seal of approval, so people thought it was okay.
It's been here since plants inhabited the earth. Vicodin, that's human created, that's chemically created, that's not natural. Putting a pill in, you don't know what's in it. Here you can open up a jar, you can sniff it, you can smell it, you can touch it, you can look at it, you know exactly what you're getting.
The government cannot protect anyone from anything, much less from themselves. It's not physically possible, and it certainly is incredibly destructive the more they try.
They sent my 7-month-old son a letter saying I was dead, and thank God he can't read, but needless to say, I was a little bit pissed.
Basically, I was just sitting in my house, chilling, hanging out, and some kids set a couch on the side of our building on fire. Two police officers followed the firefighters inside. He takes all of our statements about the fire, kind of making it sound like we were the ones that set the couch on fire. He turns to me and says, "Ms. Flieger, is there anything in your house that we need to know about?" Didn't know any of my rights, so I was just honest with him, and I was like, "Well, yeah, there is." And then he asked if we had any weed, and I said, "Yeah, probably just personal amounts." So I went in the room, and I was giving him all our bongs and everything, and from there, he basically was just like, "I need you to turn around and put your hands behind your back," and he was like, "I have enough here to charge you with felonies, but since you were cooperative and stuff, I'm gonna drop it down to 2 misdemeanors." Like, he's, you know, cutting me a break, pushed me up against the car, and I was just in my freaking shorts and my pajamas and my slippers. He had the handcuffs on me so tight that my fingers starting to turn purple, and I didn't have hardly any circulation left in my hands by the time we got to the jailhouse. My grandma and my uncle are judging me for it, and I mean, I have grandparents all over that have read it in the newspapers and plastering my face all over the news and, you know, making it seem like I'm just some kind of big old drug dealer, and I just like to sit in my house and chill and smoke pot.
How can you tell a good law from a bad law? Since laws dictate action and are backed by action, it's the same as telling a good act from a bad act. Any action is bad if it forces anyone to do anything. Any action is good if everyone involved is involved voluntarily.
Public schools are the ultimate tool of the politicians and the do-gooders to take control of our children's lives and souls and bodies. They are slavery factories.
Well, public schools, which I call government schools, are bad in the fact that they teach the doctrine of the day, you know, whatever people feel that they, whatever values they should impose on others, that's what they're teaching. It goes a whole lot more than the 3 R's. Probably half the school day could be composed of innuendo, slanting the news, and just general information that the kids don't even realize they're picking up. Trust me, I've had 2 daughters raised in the California public school system, and they are typically what you might expect a result of 12 years of public education in California.
A study released today shows that the United States leads the world in incarceration, largely from nonviolent drug and weapons offenses. A total of 7.3 million Americans are in the penal system, either in jail or prison or on probation or parole. Now, to put that in perspective, our per capita prison population is 5 times that of the United Kingdom, 9 times that of France, and 12 times that of Japan.
I don't do drugs. but I understand that freedoms are interrelated. If you let the man take away one right, it makes it a lot easier for the man to take away another right, which is why true advances in liberty will never happen until the gun folk and the dope folk quit the fussing and the fighting.
The war on drugs is theft of honest goods, literally at gunpoint. It's just a redistribution of wealth, stealing from honest people and giving to tax eaters. It's immoral. War is only justified if you are attacked.
Property is anything that one has acquired without coercion, without theft, without fraud. It makes no difference what it is, guns or marijuana or anything else that one acquires without harming another person is rationally legal property.
When you take guns out of the hands of honest, good, upstanding citizens, then the only people who have the potential to commit violence are criminals. Therefore, they have a monopoly on that, unless you're willing to sit around and wait and hope that the police show up in a timely manner to stop them.
When seconds count, the police are only minutes away.
All aggression is violence, but not all violence is necessarily aggression. If a person comes after me with a weapon or without a weapon and intends to do me harm, they've already initiated aggression against me, which is violence. However, if I stand my ground and use violence in return, I'm not initiating aggression. I'm not aggressing against them. I'm acting purely in self-defense. And I think that that's one of the concepts that a lot of the so-called gun grabbers don't understand. They don't differentiate between the use of a gun for self-defense and the use of a gun for aggression. Aggression is always immoral. It's always immoral to aggress against someone else.
Most of the bad peace officers don't call themselves peace officers. They call themselves officers of the state, or in other words, they're part of the police state. And they think that their job is to write as many tickets as they can, to make as many arrests as they can. And a true peace officer is there to protect people, not just make arrests.
There should be no distinction between government men and citizens. If we're all equal, then we should all have equal access to protection.
If we're going to get our country back, if we're going to get American constitutional liberty back, the states, the counties, and cities, working with their people, again, remembering that we the people are the power source in this country for all political power.
My gun is a Glock Model 22. It's a 40 caliber, semi-automatic. Can you see it? I'll remove it from its holster. It normally does not leave its holster under any condition. There it is right there.
I can chip your finger off the trigger.
Never goes on it. It stays in the holster when I'm out in public. I've been carrying this weapon in the open for 7 years now. Not once has it ever come out of its holster in public.
George Mason said that the militia was the people. So the reference to the militia in the Second Amendment is just talking about the people, because the people are the militia. And George Mason also said that to disarm the people is the best and most effectual way to enslave them. And so those of you who would enslave us in this country, Charles Schumer and Dianne Feinstein and Harry Reid and Nancy Pelosi and Barack Obama, and all of the czars in his administration, I challenge you to, for once in your careers and life, support American idealism and support what America was based on. You are leading us away from American ideals.
The difference between good laws and bad laws? Well, there's only one good law, and that is the law of non-aggression. All other laws that are good must proceed from that.
I sued the Clinton administration and lived to tell about it. One thing that it says in there is that the states and the counties and the political subdivisions of the state are just as supreme as the federal government. And who said that? The United States Supreme Court. And if you look at the strength and the power of the 10th Amendment and state sovereignty, it was never intended by our Constitution to create another tyrannical government worse than the one that we separated from in the Revolutionary War. And so, no, the states did not create the federal government to be our master or our supreme being. They can quote that supremacy clause all they want, it'd be nice if they quote it instead of just saying that it gives them supreme power, because it doesn't appear that any of them have ever read it. But they never read any of the other laws that they pass and shove down our throats. It just is another sign of the corruption in Washington, D.C.
Some people are hungry for liberty because deep down inside they know they are self-owners. Unfortunately, a lot of people don't understand that and have even been conditioned no longer to feel that. Why should they? Because it is our birthright as human beings.
Well, the difference between illegal and immoral is I don't need a law to tell me what is immoral. Inherently, you know right from wrong. Illegal is something imposed on you by the government. It's what they think is right and wrong.
The only way to get back to voluntary self-government is to become self-owners.
I don't have any right to tell Eric what he can and can't do with his Ericness. And I don't expect to be told what to do with my Anastasianness.
Whether you're a gun owner or a weed smoker, it's all the same issue. Do you have the right to protect yourself and to live your own life as you see fit without the government trying to force you one way or the other into a behavior that they deem is proper? As long as you're causing no harm to somebody else, you should be able to do whatever you want.
Everything Hitler did was legal because he made the laws. We're not recommending you break any laws. We're not even saying,
every time you break an unjust law, an angel gets your wings.
However, Martin Luther King Jr. said, one may well ask, how can you advocate breaking some laws and obeying others? The answer lies in the fact that there are two types of laws, just and unjust. I would be the first to advocate obeying just laws. One has not only a legal, but a moral responsibility to obey just laws. Conversely, one has a moral responsibility to disobey unjust laws. What we will say is this: when you give oppressors an inch, they take a light year. Every time.
Jesus was very definitely killed by the government, and for the same reason that they continue to kill us today. He was not willing to be controlled.
Any law that protects me from violence perpetrated upon me from somebody else would be a good law. If somebody wants to come to my house and shoot me, kill me, steal my property, burn my house, there should be a law against that. And there are laws against that. Bad laws, on the other hand, are laws where there's really no victim. A law requiring a hairdresser to get a license.
They definitely are starting to tighten the chokehold on us. The state is, you know, putting more and more regulations and laws. It seems like every week we have to stay on top of it, making sure we're still compliant with everything.
Or that you can only have one liquor store every mile.
Wyoming State Senator Cale Case put it well. He said, I don't like being exposed to Kenny G's music, cigarette smoke, or patchouli oil, but I will defend the right of other folks to have all that junk, the right of business owners to allow it, and my right not to have to be around it. Government should not regulate anything that citizens can avoid by turning around and walking out.
Governments have set things up so that people don't have a choice to walk away.
Laws against personal freedom, such as smoking pot or drinking alcohol or any number of basic things that you might do in any given day.
Natural rights are just simply our right to life. Every human being has the right to life and to defend that life.
Citizens should be able to own guns. Without a doubt, I think everybody has the right to protect themselves, period. I don't care if it's walking across the street or in your home or in your front yard. I think everybody should have the right to protect themselves.
And to acquire and use peacefully acquired property with no interference from anyone else.
We need our freedom. This country was built on freedom. Mm-hmm. That every citizen of this country has the right to prosper as long as it is not affecting anything or anyone negatively.
Mm-hmm. No voluntary consensual activity can legitimately be illegal.
Natural rights are not divisible. The Bill of Rights is not a Chinese takeout menu where we can have one from column A, one from column B, and eliminate column C. We cannot allow anyone to pick or choose our rights for us. The Bill of Rights is one single declaration with 10 sections.
When we allow so-called authorities or politicians to take away or abrogate a right, we become their slaves. We have abdicated ownership of our own bodies and lives. And it doesn't make any difference at all whether that's guns or marijuana or automobiles or our marriages.
The Bill of Rights and all natural rights are all or none.
Violence isn't necessarily a bad thing if it's used in self-defense. It's never immoral to stand your ground and defend yourself, your life, your liberty, your property, or that of another person who is suffering from the aggression of another. Aggression involves committing a crime against the natural rights of another person. Self-defense, even including violence, involves defending one's natural rights to life, liberty, and property.
30 years ago, I was sleeping and heard an argument outside and looked out the window to see someone who was trying to break into my car. I went to the closet and retrieved my shotgun and went to the door and opened it and shouted at him to go away, to get away from my car. He started toward me. I leveled the shotgun at him as he came toward me, and he was threatening me and said that he would kill me. When I said, stop, I'll shoot. And he said, oh, you won't shoot me. And then I did.
And she ended up getting off because of it. And it shows you some text and stuff at the end of the film. And then it's the credits, and that's pretty much the end. And she was in her full right to defend herself in her home. She did not go to jail, did not go to prison. She was not an evil killer. She was defending herself. She was a woman by herself who told this guy, who was obviously drunk or high or on something, and not high on cannabis. Nobody smokes a joint and goes and tries to kill people. Probably drunk more than likely, but maybe PCP, whatever. And he got aggressive and he came at her. And she leveled the shotgun and she said, keep coming, I'm going to shoot you. And he didn't think she'd shoot. And he kept walking. And she shot him. And he died. That's the way it works. You're allowed to defend yourself. Just because the state or some propaganda machine makes you feel bad about it, don't buy into it, especially if you're a woman. I want to do a show on guns again because I've been getting emails about this. I did this probably about 2 years ago with Joe. We covered it briefly. But I think I'm going to have to do a show about this. Like get into at least an hour, maybe at least like a half hour is not enough. I'll have to do like an hour. One of my broadcasts, I'll focus like an hour about first-time gun buying for novices who've never, ever, ever bought a gun, and I will break it down for men and women because there is a distinct difference between the two when carrying and when it comes to guns. And women seem to be more comfortable with revolvers and other stuff. But anyway, I'll get into that. I don't want to get sidetracked. I only have about a minute and a half left. But I hope you learned something from tonight's broadcast. I hope you I hope you at least understand that all these walls of division that we have up, we create them. It's been programmed into us by the powers that shouldn't be, through our parents and teachers and everybody around us in society, and then we do it to ourselves and to each other as we get older, and then to our own kids, right? Repeat the cycle. But I'm doing this and I'm showing you guys this stuff, showing you that we have more in common than we do differences. Maybe you can break down these walls and people can realize that just because someone smokes pot and you don't doesn't mean they're an evil person. And you should stand up for their right to do so too. Same thing with guns or freedom of speech. It's amazing how many people will stand up for one right but then attack another.
This is Sparta!
As I said, they keep us divided. They're getting us to tear ourselves apart from the inside, ladies and gentlemen. But we can stop it. As I always tell you, the solutions to our problems are an inside job. Well, let's look to ourselves and solve these problems. I love you all. I'll see you all again tomorrow night. I'm out.